That's the third cigar you smoked tonight.
Don't you want me to be a film producer?
Yes, of course I do.
Well, you'll have to stop counting the cigars I smoke. How am I going to make people believe that I'm a film producer if I'm not allowed to smoke cigars all the time?
You could try shaving.
Oh, that's ridiculous. I'm growing this for my next picture. You know that.
Yes, and if you weren't growing a beard, you'd be practicing an accent or a limp or something. There's no mistaking you. You're an actor.
You think so?
Mm-hmm. And right now you look like an actor smoking a big cigar.
Oh.
What is this? Pamela and James Mason in a charade?
Well, that's the film that I thought we might produce.
Is this something you've written?
No, it's mostly something that you've written. Do you remember these?
Oh, yes. That's that story about the strangler in Paris that we wrote. That's the Dumas story. And that's the idea we had for a comedy to work out.
That's right. Well, it occurred to me that none of these would make a full-length movie. They're just anecdotes, you know?
You mean we should put them all together and make a sort of trio?
Well, why not? Other people have done it.
Talk about film, sir.
Well, you don't have to do it if you don't like it. It's worth discussing. It shouldn't be very difficult. Now, let's just think what we should need. Well, first of all, we should need a camera. Some sound equipment. Some lamps and one of these gadgets. We wouldn't need a very big stage, just big enough to put up about half a dozen sets. And of course, we'd need some actors. For this first piece, they'd have to be able to speak French, seeing that it all takes place in Paris. You and I can play the leads if we can't think of anyone more suitable. I'll shave my beard off, naturally. Can I think of anything else?
Nice pictorial shot of Paris.
The Arc de Triomphe. What could be nicer?
Now Paris is lovely again. I can sit by my window and enjoy the pale September sunshine. Only a few weeks ago, I was desperate and ready to throw myself in the river. Even the glitter of Paris could no longer find a reflection in my unhappy, lonely spirit. But now all that has changed. I can explore the scene of my failure with bright eyes and a pounding heart, because I know that soon he'll be with me again. When I first came to Paris 5 years ago, I imagined I'd have no difficulty selling my work. I couldn't even sell those trash baskets I painted. I completely failed. The nuns are looking after her. She must be quite a big girl now. I was going to say I married this man, but more correctly, he married me because I didn't love him. Sometimes I give lessons on the piano. I never play for my own pleasure, because the girl in the next room played all day long. She played Viennese waltzes very badly. She kept making mistakes and going back. She murdered Strauss, and I remember thinking how nice it would be if someone murdered her. Which brings me to my story. I wasn't in the habit of listening to my neighbors' conversations. It was a hot night and I couldn't sleep. There was a man in the room with her, and it must have been he who was playing the piano. It was very different from the way she played. There was something about his voice that intrigued me. They were both speaking French, but it seemed to me that the man spoke with an English accent. I could swear it. I never slept at all that night. Early in the morning, I heard the concierge knock on my neighbor's door. There was no answer, so she opened the door and went in. Then she let out a scream that was enough to waken the whole district. She screamed for the police, the ambulance, the fire brigade, and from then on, it was like the monkey house at the zoo. I felt strangely excited. I had a secret. I knew the man who'd caused this commotion. could remember just how his face looked as he stood under the naked light in the corridor. There was a bond between this man and myself. He came from the same country, spoke the same language, shared my secret. I didn't want to lose my newly found importance and my pride of ownership. For the man with the English voice belonged to me. Not to these monkeys who squealed and chattered in the corridor and on the staircase. I wasn't going to give him up to them. I told the police that I'd slept soundly all night. I'd heard nothing, seen no one. The exhilaration stayed with me. I even managed to sell some paintings. And I made up my mind to save the money I'd earned and go back to England. I'd no right to expect ever to see my Englishman again. But his constant presence in my subconscious mind drew me away from Paris to a background where our paths were more likely to intersect. Suddenly, my life stood still. It said in the paper that a man had been taken into custody and charged with the murder of Marie Delbecq. That was the girl in the next room. The man's name was Jean-Marie Partigon.
Excusez-moi. Pouvez-vous m'indiquer où se trouve le bistrot le plus proche où la nourriture est excellente? Je suis nouveau dans cet arrache.
Je peux que mon français ne soit pas très bon.
Do you speak English?
I am English.
So am I.
Well, then perhaps you'd tell me again all that you were just trying to tell me.
I've just rented the room next to yours, and not being familiar with the district, I wondered if you could recommend a good bistro in the street.
You rented that room?
Yes. Why'd you say it like that? Is there any reason why I shouldn't?
No. Oh, didn't anyone tell you?
Tell me what?
No business of mine. But the girl who had the room before was killed. Murdered.
Yes, I rather gathered that from something the concierge let slip.
Won't that put you off?
Quite honestly, no. Poor woman, she was trying so hard to keep it from me.
Aren't you afraid that... I mean, won't it make you feel...
You mean, won't I be afraid of being haunted by the spirit of the dead woman? No. I don't think I will be. Being accustomed to cheap lodgings, I've cultivated an unawareness of my surroundings, which is sometimes extremely helpful.
I was just making some coffee. Would you like to join me?
Thank you very much. I would. Did you do this?
Yes, it's just a sketch.
It's very striking. The effect of the light on the man's head. I like it. Perhaps that's because it looks a bit like me. Or am I flattering myself?
No, I think I see what you mean. Something about the eyes and the jawline.
Is it from life? I mean, did you use a model? Is it someone you know?
Oh, no. It's just an experiment in light and shade. Just an exercise.
Well, if you're planning to finish it and would like to use a real live model, don't forget your new neighbor.
I'll take you up on that.
Just knock on the wall and I'll come running. Thank you.
I learned a lot about this man in the first few days I knew him. That is, I learned all the things about which I had no great curiosity. At present, he worked in the Paris office of an American travel agency. It was the quiet season and he had time on his hands. He could relax and do nothing, just as he was doing now. Max, has anyone ever really known you? Max?
Do you mind repeating the question? I was a long way away.
Yes, I could see you were. I asked if anyone had ever really known you. I can imagine a woman being married to you for years and years and knowing less about you at the end of it than she did at the beginning. Have you ever allowed anyone to unravel you?
Anyone is welcome to try. I would have thought I was quite easy to unravel, though I have to admit my wife didn't get very far.
Your wife? I didn't know you had a wife.
I haven't. She died. It was strictly a surface relationship. As I recall, she had a very attractive surface. I can't say that I've missed her.
You have a way of saying things. I never know whether you're serious or not.
You think I'm trying to camouflage my deeper thoughts?
Yes.
Very well, I'll make a bargain with you. I'll tell you exactly what's in my mind if you'll oblige me in the same way.
I'll risk it.
First of all, there's a recurrent thought that's been pestering me all afternoon. I've been saying to myself, next time she takes the brush out of her mouth, I shall have to kiss her. Then there's a bigger thought that's been droning away like a theme song. It goes like this. I, but to die, and go we know not where, to lie in cold obstruction and to rot, this sensible warm motion to become a kneaded clod.
Well, I'm not very flattered. One breath you say you want to kiss me, and then turns out you've been rehearsing some gloomy piece about death in the back of your mind.
Do you know what day it is today?
Wednesday, isn't it?
Just a day, like any other day. Is there nothing special about it?
No, is there?
A man is on trial for his life. The case opened today.
Oh, yes, that.
Had you forgotten?
Oh, I hadn't forgotten. I just hadn't thought about it. I hardly knew her. It's no reason why it should concern me.
Yes, but you're an artist. You have imagination, curiosity, haven't you? To cause death is such a simple trick. But the act of dying is a challenge to the intellect. The newspaper owner has the highest regard for death in all its forms, but especially for one that's passionately executed. Now, here's today's evening paper, and characteristically, someone has left it open at page 2, where the headline reads, Partagon Trial Opens Today.
Yes, I read it. But I'm not like the average newspaper reading public. I get no kick out of murders.
Not even a murder so close to home?
No.
Now answer me this, and remember that we're supposed to be telling each other the truth this afternoon. Do you always buy the evening paper?
Not always.
And you get no kick reading about murders?
No.
Well, I do. I got to talking to one of the inspectors on this case. Would you like me to tell you how I think this Partagon went about it? Reconstruct the crime, as they say?
How can I stop you?
What were you doing that night? Was anyone with you or were you alone?
I was alone.
Well, didn't you hear anything? Strangulation is no child's play. Chairs fall over. Things get broken.
I heard nothing. I was asleep all night.
It was a hot night, as I recall.
I never have any trouble sleeping.
Not even when she played the piano?
How do you know she played the piano?
The concierge told me. I gather she didn't play very well.
Do you know Invitation to the Dance?
I know how it goes.
That was her favorite piece. Play it for me.
I have a beautiful piano in my own room and I can't play a note of music. Sickening, isn't it? I'll take you out to dinner now. You've done enough painting for one day. We can reconstruct the crime over the dessert.
I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that it was he who had played so beautifully that night. I knew that he must have murdered Marie Delbecq. Although he did not reconstruct the crime over the dessert as he threatened, indeed the subject was not discussed for several days, I knew that sooner or later he would return to it. I loved the worst thing in life. A man who was so sick that he could murder a fellow creature and having done so would rather haunt the scene than run away to the ends of the earth. Perhaps I'm sick too. I didn't tell the police what I knew. I haven't run away. I don't love him in spite of what he's done. I love him because of it. During the air raids in the last war, there were many women who were well aware that the whole thing was hateful and horrifying, and yet dreaded a return to the emptiness of life without bombs. One day, his frightening talk of death will start again, and I seem to be waiting with a morbid longing for the next bomb to drop. Entree? Oh, darling. I get so lonely when you're gone all day. Where have you been?
Even during the quiet season, there's work to be done. People have started making reservations at Chamonix for the winter sports. I brought you an evening paper. There's something in it that I thought might amuse you. Seeing that your French is so bad, I'll translate. The fire engine slowed down and came to a standstill in the Place Chambige. What had they come here to do, ces braves pompiers, these brave firemen? A little black and white cat was lodged in the branches of a high tree. The hero of the hour ascends the ladder as if carried on wings and brings the cat The owner, weeping copiously, clutches the cat against his heart. But the cat, still distressed by its adventure, scratches the owner on the cheeks and neck and leaps out of his arms and runs down the street. The efforts of the brave fireman have been to no avail. Evidently, fate had singled out this animal for destruction, for in crossing the Avenue Montaigne, it collides with a taxi cab, and a passing truck then extinguishes its life.
What a horrible story. Wish you hadn't read it out to me.
Oh, I'm sorry, darling. I suppose I should have known better. I keep forgetting that to the average woman, the death of a cat is far more affecting than the death of a human being. The poor beetle that we tread upon in corporeal sufferance finds a pang as great as when a giant dies. This paper's full of jolly little items tonight. Did you see the headline? The jury retires.
Is it all over then? Are there no more witnesses?
Partagon was the last witness. He was on the stand for 3 hours. He's had it, I'm afraid.
Oh, he's a horrible looking little man, isn't he? Those eyes. First here, he was a hero of the resistance during the war.
He's also spent 10 years of his life in jail. Robbery, forgery, assaulting policemen.
Yes, but never anything like this.
Well, who knows how many people he's killed. Do you know how many unsolved murders take place in Paris each year?
No.
Neither do I. But you can be sure that the police are not as omniscient as they would have you believe. We know that Patagon was a past master at knifing Germans in the back. Now, that, of course, doesn't count. That was during the open season.
I want to read what he says.
Why don't you pour the coffee while I summarize the evidence for you? Only one interesting thing came out. At the speed you read French, it'll take you all night to get to it. The prosecution established that Patagon had been seen entering the building at 9:30. That he'd been drinking heavily, and that the police picked him up out of the gutter outside the bar on the next corner at 12:30. He'd been seen several times in the company of the murdered girl, and once had been heard quarreling and threatening violence. He was known to have a jealous disposition, and Marie Delbecq was not strictly a one-man girl. Bardigan himself was the only witness for the defense, and on the stand gave an extremely impressive performance, lucid and even gallant. You could see that the jury wanted to believe him. His words had the ring of truth about them.
You say that as if you were there.
I was. I slipped into the back of the court. As a matter of fact, I've been there throughout the trial, on and off. Now, to come to the interesting part of Patagon's testimony.
But you never told me.
Told you what?
That you'd been to the trial.
I didn't think you'd be interested.
I want it to be over.
He hasn't a chance. There were only two men living in the house at the time. And both of them had perfect alibis. Patagon was the only man seen leaving or entering the house that night. All the residents were questioned by the police, including yourself, I understand. And none of them admitted to having heard or seen anything unusual. No commotion, no comings and goings, nothing. Now, suppose that one of these residents suffered a change of heart and suddenly remembered things that he or she had heard that night, but which in the tumult she'd suppressed. Perhaps she'd been protecting someone, her boyfriend, say. And now, pricked by conscience, she went to the police and made a full report. Do you think they'd believe her?
I don't know. I don't see what this has to do with anything. I thought you were going to tell me about Partigan's evidence.
The answer is no, they wouldn't believe her.
So?
So Partigan hasn't a chance. At least he wouldn't have had without the rather exciting statement he made towards the close of his testimony.
Oh, what was it? What did he say?
He said that as he was leaving the building, he brushed up against a man who was standing just inside the doorway. Although he was drunk, he remembered having tried to get into conversation with this man, but the man wouldn't answer. He just stood there quietly, and after a moment, he moved away and started up towards the stairs.
But did he describe the man?
He tried to, but there was evidently nothing very distinctive about the man's appearance. No major disfigurements, no heavy mustache. Only one thing. Bardigon said that the man was carrying a bunch of white flowers. That's an interesting touch, isn't it?
Yes, but I don't see how it's likely to help him. The flowers are not likely to be a permanent feature.
Exactly. And Bardigon could easily have invented them because the police were known to have found a vase of marguerites in the girl's room. You know what marguerites are?
Yes, they're like big daisies, aren't they?
Yes. They're very pretty flowers. I like them. But you see the point I'm trying to make. This story is absolutely no use to him as it stands, but if there had been anyone who'd seen a man in the building that night, and if that man could be produced for identification...
Oh, darling, please don't go on about it. You said yourself Partigan hasn't a chance. And in this country, the accused is guilty till he proves himself innocent. Isn't that true?
Yes, that's true.
Well, then, he'll never do that. If anyone else did see the man with the white flowers, they're going to keep quiet about it. Of all her neighbors, I'm most likely to have seen her visitors. They have to go past my room, and half the time I don't even keep my door shut. And I saw no one. I told you. If the man with the white flowers really exists, and if he has any sense, he's thousands of miles away by now, probably in another country.
He might have to live here. He might earn his living here. He might be emotionally attached to this quarter. He might even be an unusual type, a poet or a dreamer. You've no right to impute common sense to people you know nothing about.
Oh, don't go on about something we all want to forget.
Speak for yourself.
All these pointless speculations. Even if Partigan goes to the guillotine, no one will ever really know whether he's guilty or not.
The man with a bunch of marguerites will know. He'll go on knowing. He'll live in fear that someone else knows.
He doesn't exist, my darling. I swear it. Oh, my love, don't let's talk about it anymore.
I'm sorry. I won't say another word. I should have stopped when you asked me to.
Let's go away. Oh, Max, let's go far away. This is a sad place for me. I've hated it for years. Before you came and took the room next door, I was so lonely, so desperate. I had nothing to live for. Everything I touched failed. I hated all the dirty, sordid people who lived in this horrible house. I hated to hear them laugh, knowing that they were happy, while only I was utterly lonely. I failed as a wife and as a mother. And I failed as a painter, too. Let's go to England, Max. I haven't been there for 5 years. Sometimes now I feel a dreadful longing not to be a foreigner anymore. Take me there, Max.
I find it stimulating. I like the September sunshine and the laughter and the flowers. Why do you look at me like that?
Piano.
Oh, I'm inconsiderate, forgive me. That was the waltz she played, wasn't it? I've stopped now. I don't think you should regard yourself as a failure. I think you're a very good painter. I'll show you what I mean. Where's that sketch you did of me?
What sketch?
You know the one I mean. Before you started that canvas, you did a sketch. Remember, you were working on it when I first came into your room. The effect of the light on my head. It's very clever.
Oh, that wasn't of you. That was just...
Of course. It was just a man. I remember you telling me. Where is it?
I don't know. I probably threw it away.
It's in that corner among the canvases. Get it for me. Quickly. I want to look at it again. Come here. Closer to me. I want to put my arm around you. Now, do you see anything funny about this sketch? I think it's a delightful touch. I spotted it at once.
Whatever it is, it must be an accident. It was just a quick sketch.
You know now, don't you? You spotted it too. You didn't realize at first, but now you get the implication.
I don't know what you're talking about.
What's that? Answer me, what is it?
It's just a flower. Just a flower in a man's buttonhole. Just something I imagined. Lots of men wear flowers.
No, they don't. They wear roses, yes, and carnations, sometimes even gardenias. But how often do you see a man with a daisy in his buttonhole? That's a marguerite, unmistakably. This isn't an imaginary sketch. You didn't imagine that flower. You saw it in my buttonhole when I came out of her room and paused on the landing under the light facing your open doorway.
Let me forget it, Max. I can make myself believe it never happened. I swear, no matter what you do, I'll never give you away. I love you. You're the most wonderful thing that ever happened to me. I was never going to let you suspect what I knew. I wanted to keep you. That's why I lied to the police. Didn't you love me then? Wasn't it true then? You weren't just pretending to love me, were you?
No, I loved you. Although I knew it would have to end like this.
Don't, Max!
Because it has to end like this, and because you're more than a little mad, that makes you my perfect love. This is a love that will never wilt. It will survive like a pressed flower. I shall never learn that you're stupid or shallow or inconstant. Jealousy and disillusion will never make you hateful or dangerous. Now you can't even hear me say it. I love you. By your death, I swear it.
Monsieur le sergent, venez ici. Ceci est intéressant. Portrait of the murderer. Ça veut dire portrait de meurtrier. Qu'en pensez-vous?
Bon, je ne sais pas. C'est sans doute une femme très excentrique, vous savez. En tout cas, en bas l'essai et l'emmener au commissariat.
So the police sergeant says to the other policeman, let's wrap it up and take it down to police headquarters. It's quite a good likeness. They'll probably be able to identify the murderer from it.
Is that how you're going to end the story?
Well, what more do you want? Nice little execution scene. I must admit, guillotines are rather picturesque. But people are liable to be rather squeamish about that sort of thing.
I don't blame them. This looks more likely.
What's that you got?
This is the Dumas subject, one with a duel. You remember it. And it's your chance to play a hero.
Here, let me see how it ends. Ah, yes. I think I'd rather play the villain. The better part.
Oh, no, please.
Well, we don't have to decide right now. Let's just think about it. Let's just try to imagine how it'll look on the screen. The officers' mess of an Austrian regiment stationed near the Polish border in the middle of the last century. A time when a man's honor was his most precious possession, and an insult could only be wiped out in blood.
Well, that finishes this game, gentlemen.
Yes, I'm afraid so. You win again, Lieutenant.
Yes, I never thought I'd win that one.
I think that makes another 24, I owe.
I hope you haven't lost too heavily this evening, Captain.
No, not very much. You were extremely lucky.
Yes, I know. I find it a little embarrassing to keep winning from my superior officers.
You don't look embarrassed, Lieutenant. France, bring another bottle and remove these ashes. Tell me, von Buren, how's our new major at cards? Does he play well?
Only moderately well, sir. He shall be another source of income for the Lieutenant.
Good.
He'll be here in a minute. We can put him to the test.
How long have you known Major Linden?
On and off for about 10 years. We were at the military academy together.
Then perhaps you know why he was transferred from the guards to this out-of-the-way garrison.
I gather that he was wounded in the last campaign and has been posted to temporary inactive duty. He requested to be sent here for personal reasons.
Personal reasons?
Yes, he's engaged to marry the Baroness Helena Tansman, who lives with her father in this town. I understand they met a few months ago in Vienna.
Baroness Tansman, eh? Tell me, is she as beautiful as they say?
I can't vouch for that, sir, as I've never met her. But I believe Captain Stamm has.
Yes, I've met the lady. She is very beautiful.
You know her well?
No, not well. I haven't seen her for some time.
Wasn't Baroness Tansman the lady you were always visiting a year ago when I first joined the regiment?
I used to see her quite often.
But I seem to remember that he was always visiting someone almost every day.
That's right. I remember now. Yes, there was a time, Stamm, about a year ago, when we seldom enjoyed your company here in the evenings. And I accused you of carrying on a romantic liaison.
Did you, Colonel?
Yes. In fact, one evening you did admit to me that you were considering making a proposal of marriage. You even went so far as to ask my advice about the best way of approaching the lady's father.
Is that true, sir? Did you really propose marriage to the Baroness Tansman?
Of course not. This is all grossly exaggerated.
I'm sure it is. With Stam's continual bad luck at cards, I'm certain he's always extremely lucky in love.
With my continual good luck at cards, I just don't have any time for love.
Major Linden.
Paul, how nice to see you.
Max, how are you?
This is Major Linton. Colonel Heisler. Lieutenant Nyadorf. Captain Stan.
Welcome to our regiment, Major.
I'm very proud to join you, sir.
Please sit down.
Thank you.
After the distinguished regiment you've just left, I'm afraid you're going to find it rather quiet around here.
I should appreciate the rest, sir.
I'm sorry to hear about your wound, Paul. I hope it's not too serious.
No, it was very slight. Your health, gentlemen.
Your better.
I understand you play, Major. Perhaps you'd care for a game now. Name your own stakes.
Lieutenant Mayadorf, are you so anxious to fleece the Major that you can't even wait to get acquainted with him?
Oh, no, sir.
There'll be plenty of time to win his money. I'm afraid, Major, in this dull post, cards are one of our main occupations.
I don't think Paul will have much difficulty in occupying his spare time.
Oh, yes, Major Linton. I hear you've recently become engaged to be married. My congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Have you had the opportunity of seeing your fiancée since you arrived?
Yes, I had dinner with her this evening.
That's why you are unable to dine with us.
I'm sorry, sir.
Very understandable, Major. Have you found suitable lodgings in town?
Yes, sir. I've taken a house. It's a little bigger than I needed, but it has one advantage. It has a garden large enough for target practice.
Target practice, Major?
Yes, it's a habit of mine to practice shooting for half an hour every morning.
Really? What a strange form of amusement.
It's not exactly an amusement, and surely it's not strange for a soldier to keep his hand steady and his eye clear.
Linton has another reason. He's already been involved in two duels.
Yes, I've been unfortunate enough to be involved in two duels.
I don't see that you were unfortunate. You're still here. Surely it's your opponents who are unfortunate.
As it happens, both my opponents are still living. Perhaps I expressed myself badly. What I meant to say that a duel is always unfortunate for both parties involved.
And yet you practice shooting every morning to be ready for your next duel.
No, I practice shooting every morning, but in the devout hope that there will be no next.
It seems to me that there are some things in life that a gentleman leaves to chance. He does not prepare for them.
I think we've had enough of this discussion. How about that game of cards? Mayadorf, will you shuffle?
Oh, yes, sir.
Speaking of cards, let me illustrate what I mean. Pass me the deck. Now, I have no doubt that if I were to practice shuffling cards for half an hour every morning, I'd soon become very expert. So expert, in fact, that whenever it was my turn to deal, I'd always be fairly certain of giving myself the advantage.
Captain Stamm.
Yes, there we are. The four aces. I was afraid I'd forgotten the trick. I haven't done it for years. But I'm quite sure that if I practiced with the cards every day, I'd soon become very sleight of hand, which would be useful when the stakes were high and I was in a tight corner.
What exactly are you insinuating?
I'm not insinuating anything, Major. I'm merely expressing the opinion that to me there seems very little difference in principle between practicing marksmanship and practicing shuffling cards.
Are you comparing me with a card sharp?
Comparing you with a card sharp? Yes, if that's the way you wish to take it.
It's the only way I can take it. Gentlemen, enough of this. I should appreciate it if this conversation will not carry it any further. Please sit down, Major Linton. And let me give you some more wine.
How about that game Mayadorf is so anxious for?
Good idea. Will you join us, Linton?
Yes, sir.
Splendid. Let's cut for deal. High card deals.
King, I see to be the highest. Linton, I hope you won't have any objection to my dealing after showing you how expert I am in card tricks.
Any extra skill you may have, I'm sure you will not put to unfair advantage.
Thank you.
You've been at the front more recently than we have. What's your opinion on the progress of the war?
I think it's going fairly well, sir. As you know, most of the action is in the northern sector. Our lines seem to be holding firm.
I put in for a transfer to a frontline regiment. I hope to see some fighting before long.
Well, naturally, we're all anxious for more active duty. Linton, I wouldn't have thought that a man so expert in the use of firearms as yourself could be spared from the front.
You know perfectly well that Major Linton was sent here on account of his wound.
Oh, yes. Your wound. I'm glad to hear it's so slight.
Thank you. Seems a long time since we were playing cards together, Max.
Yes. Must be 4 or 5 years.
Though if it is such a slight wound, I'm surprised you should have requested to be sent away from the front.
I did not request to be sent away from the front. I was ordered to garrison duty and merely requested to be sent to this garrison.
You certainly picked one of the quietest and safest. You can practice your marksmanship in your garden without any danger of incurring further wounds.
That's enough, Captain Stamm. I won't have you talk to me like this.
I'll talk as I please. Just because you outrank me, Major, is no reason why I shouldn't speak my mind.
Rank has nothing to do with it.
Gentlemen, please.
I'm sorry, Colonel. This has gone far enough. Ever since I came into the room, this man has deliberately tried to provoke a quarrel. You've insulted me as I've never been insulted before in my life. You've virtually called me a coward to my face. I don't know why you've acted in this way, but whatever your motive, I've no alternative but to demand that you give me satisfaction.
I shall be happy to give you satisfaction, sir. Lieutenant Meyerdorf, as you were a witness to this incident, may I rely on you to give me your assistance?
Yes, Captain.
Max, can I count on you?
Of course, Paul, gladly.
Very well, then. The three of us can make the necessary arrangements. And naturally, you know, Major, that as it was you who challenged me, I have the privilege of choosing all the conditions, weapons, time, place, and distance.
Yes, I'm aware of that.
Captain Stamm, I'm at a loss to understand your behavior this evening. But now that the affair has reached this stage, it's out of my hands. However, I'm sure the matter will be conducted honorably, as befitting your rank and regiment.
I shall endeavor to conduct it honorably, sir. Of course, I'm not so well practiced in these matters as the Major.
I'm very sorry that this should have happened, sir.
It's I who must apologize to you that such a thing should have happened on your first appearance here. It was entirely unprovoked on your part. You had to do what you did. And in the circumstances, I should have done the same.
Thank you, sir.
Where shall I find you later, Paul?
I shall be at home, into the last house on Frederick Street. And Max, accept whatever conditions he demands.
Very well.
Good night, gentlemen.
Stamm, we've served together in this regiment for more than 3 years. We've never been on very intimate terms, but I thought I knew you better than this. Your complete lack of manners and your deliberate rudeness have amazed me. I should never have dreamed you capable of such conduct. What's the matter with you, man? Are you drunk?
Not in the least. I'm quite sober.
Are you? Well, I sincerely hope that all this has nothing to do with the fact that Major Linden is engaged to the Baron's townsman.
I don't want to talk about it any further, sir.
I'm sure you don't. Neither do I. I leave you gentlemen alone to settle the details of this unpleasant business.
The conditions of the duel will be as follows. The weapons, pistols, the time, tomorrow at dawn, the place, the old barn behind St. Andrew's Church. Come in.
Helena. What are you doing here?
Your servant let me in. I had to see you, Paul. Is it true?
Is what true?
That you're to fight a duel?
Yes.
Paul. Is it Captain Stamm?
Yes.
Oh, I knew it. I knew it.
Weren't you told who my opponent was to be?
No, all I heard was that the new Major who'd only just arrived was already involved in a duel.
Then how did you know it was Stamm?
Oh, something I have to tell you. I should have told you before. If I had, it might have prevented this from happening.
What is it, Helena?
Just a year ago since Captain Stamm asked me to marry him.
What?
I used to see him often. He came to the house almost every day to play chess with my father. I looked upon him as just a friend, and I thought he regarded me in the same way. And then one day he asked me to marry him. I refused and told him that if we were to remain friends, he must never mention it again, but he persisted. He did everything he could to make me change my mind. And then I became quite frightened of him. Just to get away from him that I persuaded Father to take me to Vienna, where I met you.
And since you came back from Vienna, have you seen him?
No. He called on me the day after I returned home, but I didn't see him. I wrote him a note and told him that I was engaged to marry you and asked him not to call again.
I see.
Oh, Paul, please don't fight this duel. I'm to blame for it. And if you were killed, it would be because of me. How do you think I could live the rest of my life knowing that? You mustn't, for my sake.
I'm afraid it's too late. There's nothing I can do now.
Oh, it's not too late. This stupid little town. Who cares what happens here? Whether you fight the duel or not, what does it matter?
I'm afraid it does matter.
Oh, why? Why?
darling. You know why. You know the code of honor under which we live. You know what they call a man who's insulted and then takes no action.
Words, just silly words. Code of honor, insults. What do they mean?
To a soldier, they mean practically everything.
I just don't see it. I don't.
Helena, I'm a professional soldier. And what is that? Man who wears a pretty uniform. Man who studied military tactics. Man who knows by heart the names and achievements of all the great generals of the past and hopes one day to be a great general himself. Yes, I suppose that's all part of it, but the one essential for a soldier, no matter what rank, the one justification for his existence is that his courage should never be in doubt.
Paul, nobody...
No, Helena. What you imagine would be thought of me if it were known that I could be insulted with impunity?
What does it matter what people think of you? I don't care about other people's opinions. I want you and only you. You could leave the army. We could go away and get married and live quietly somewhere in the country. It doesn't matter where.
And change my name, perhaps. No, Helena, there's no happiness for us that way.
Oh, I'm sorry, Paul. I didn't know you had a visitor.
It's all right, Max. Come in. Helena, I want you to meet my old friend, Captain Max von Buren, Baroness Tansman. Well, what have you arranged? Is it all settled? You can speak freely. The Baroness knows about it. She came here to try to persuade me not to fight.
You have my sympathy, madam. Paul, I've just left Stan. The conditions he insists on are fantastic. Meyerdorf and I argued with him for half an hour with no success.
Then I hope he accepted his terms.
Well, finally, yes, you told me to. He's determined that your steel with a pistol shall be of no advantage to you.
Yes, I'd expected that. He insists on fighting at very short range, I suppose.
Yes, Paul, very short.
Did you see he's tricked you into this? You mustn't fight him. Don't you see he's mad with jealousy?
Darling, I have no choice in the matter. If I do not accept Stamm's conditions, I shall be known as a man who only defends his honor under favorable circumstances. For me to withdraw now is exactly what he's hoping for.
What does it matter what he's hoping for? Don't let him do this to you, to us. Captain von Buren, you've known Paul longer than I have. I beg you to persuade him not to fight this duel.
Paul must do what he thinks is right.
Well, what are the conditions? Time, place.
6 o'clock tomorrow morning. The barn behind St. Andrew's Churchyard.
The distance? 15 paces? 10 paces? Less?
1 pace.
1 pace? What do you mean, 1 pace?
You are to stand 1 pace apart. Arms to be extended so that each pistol is 6 inches from the other's heart.
Each pistol 6 inches from the other's heart? This isn't a duel, it's a murder.
Don't you see, he is mad. You can't fight him. You'll both be killed.
No, they will not both be killed. Only one of the pistols is to be loaded.
You rang, m'lady?
Yes, Anna.
You've heard about the duel?
Yes, m'lady. Everyone's heard about it.
You know the old barn? The back of St. Andrew's Churchyard?
Yes, I know it.
That's where the duel is to be held. I want you to go there before 6 o'clock and give this letter to Major Linden. I want you to be sure he gets it before he goes into the barn. And then I want you to wait there at a distance so that the others don't see you. And when you see whether Major Linden or Captain Stamm is the survivor, I want you to come back here and tell me. Do you understand?
Yes, m'lady. Will you be waiting here?
Yes, Anna, I will. Good night.
Good night, m'lady.
My darling father, this is perhaps the last letter I shall ever write to you. Tomorrow morning, a duel is to take place between Captain Stamm and Major Linden, whom you know I love more than anyone in the world. The terms of the duel are such that one of them is bound to be killed. And if it is Paul, as I'm terribly afraid it will be, then it will be impossible for me to go on living. I will complete this letter to you tomorrow morning after the duel, when I know Paul's fate and mine.
Major Linden?
Yes? Thank you.
You must be early.
Paul, this is one last plea. I beg you to put our love before everything else and not to go through with the duel. For the sake of both our lives. I love you and need you.
Oh, here's Colonel Heisler. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning. Major Linden, allow me to present Dr. Colmar. You know von Buren, I believe, Doctor.
I apologize for getting you up so early, sir. I see you brought your instruments with you.
Yes. But if this duel is going to be fought under the conditions described to me, I don't think they'll be of much use. It is obvious that no one will be wounded. One of you will be dead.
Good morning. Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
Well, is everyone ready? Shall we commence? It's just about to strike six.
Before we go any further, I assume there's no hope of reconciling you two gentlemen. But surely it's not too late to change the fantastic conditions under which you're to fight.
The conditions were agreed to by both parties, and I don't propose to change them. Of course, if Major Linden is afraid to engage in a duel in which he has no advantage and wishes to withdraw, I'm sure we shall all understand.
Let us proceed.
Meyerdorf, will you mark the distance?
Who is to give the command to fire?
You, Colonel?
No, I'd rather not.
I'd be very grateful if you would, sir.
Very well. I should say, take aim. I shall then count one, two, three. On the word three, you will both fire. Pistols. Just a moment. Stam, do you know which of these two pistols is loaded?
What does it matter, since Linden has the choice?
Will you take your positions, gentlemen? Are you ready, Captain Stamm?
Quite ready.
And you, Major Linden?
Yes, sir.
Well, how do you feel now? In these circumstances, all those hours of target practice are rather wasted, aren't they?
Take aim. One.
Unlucky choice.
Fire.
When I'm ready, perhaps I won't have to. If you would like to withdraw your challenge and apologize, I'd be glad to let you live.
Fire, Stam, fire!
You only have to say the word, Linden, and you'll save your life.
Fire!
Yes, I must confess I've played a little trick. Neither of the pistols was loaded. You're a braver man than I expected, Linden.
Stay where you are, Stan. I've not yet grasped the full significance of what you've just done, but I'm sure it's one of the most despicable acts I've ever witnessed.
Really, Colonel? Would you prefer it if Linden lay there dead?
That is not the point.
Meyerdorf, did you know that neither of the pistols was loaded?
No. Captain Stan didn't give them to me until just before we got here. He told me one of them was loaded. I'm sorry, sir. I suppose I should have examined them.
That's all right, Lieutenant.
Captain Stamm, without any risk or danger to yourself, you've put Major Linden through a terrible ordeal. You've made him go through all the sensations of a man facing certain death, while you yourself remain perfectly at ease. It is not conduct befitting an officer of this regiment.
or any other regiment. And I'm sure I speak for all of us when I say we cannot continue to serve with you. I should be obliged if within 24 hours you let me have a letter resigning your commission.
As you wish.
A very clever little scheme.
Yes, Paul. If you had weakened, if you had begged for your life as he expected you to, he wouldn't have had to fire his pistol, and his trick would never have been discovered.
I'd like to say how proud I am of the way you conducted yourself.
Fred, there's very little to be proud of.
On the contrary, after this incident, no one's likely to question your honor or bravery.
Stationed my maid, Anna, down the road at the corner to watch them return from the duel. And only a few moments ago, she saw Stan go by, alone. So forgive me, and take care of yourself always. Your loving daughter, Helena.
At least no shooting. It was a trick.
But Stan went by. Stan went by alone.
And you thought that I... Oh.
No, no. No, Paul. Promise me that...
Helena. Do you really love me as much as that?
Yes, Paul.
Then I'll promise anything you ask.
Promise me no matter what happens, you'll never fight another duel.
I promise that no matter what happens, I'll never fight another duel.
We have so much to live for.
I promise never to fight another duel, he says. I think he'll keep his promise.
I think that lady will be capable of keeping him in line.
I'm sure they both have the best intentions in the world, but a man can't change his nature. Now, this particular fellow seemed to be such a sanctimonious type that people will go on provoking him to fighting duels for the rest of his life. And provided he stays in the army, he can't very well duck them. Remember, he'd been involved in two duels before the story started.
I assume you'd rather play the villain.
Yes, I would, but that's beside the point. What's that you've got there? Is that the Midas touch?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's just what we want, to prove the point I was trying to make. You see, after a man reaches the age of 40, the pattern of his life is completely formed. His impulses, his tastes are then constant. He's incapable of change. He can change his occupation, he can try living somewhere else, but basically the pattern remains always the same. Now this, as I recall, is the case history of a man who happened to possess one very slender talent, the talent for making money. That's all he can do.
I call it rather an attractive talent.
Well, that may be, but it's pathetic to watch a man like that try and even seriously believe that he can do other things. Let's just think about it while he tells his own story. I came to New York 16 years ago, and within a year of my arrival, I'd made my first million. After that, it seemed that nothing could go wrong. I had the Midas touch. I rarely touched an oil well, but it gushed. At my touch, wastelands begat housing estates, corner drugstores became skyscrapers, securities became gilt-edged. The dormant and inactive sprang to life the moment my signature appeared on a contract. Nor was the effectiveness of my touch limited to the inanimate. For instance, my hand brushed lightly against that of the merest car hop, and almost overnight she became a television star.
He said, sure, I expect you to look sophisticated. I said, and you dress every night. That's the least the public expects. And what do you think he said?
I've no idea. Give me Blodgett's in San Francisco.
He said, so what are you beefing about? It's deductible.
Deductible, huh? He has a point there.
Deductible, my foot. I can't afford it.
Get me Blodgett's in San Francisco.
I see that you have some pretty things. Oh, I forgot to ask you. How did the TV show go last night?
Oh, there was one man in the audience I could have killed. He kept laughing right out loud.
Laughing?
Can you imagine?
Good?
I mean, I'd be be reading a poem, say, that someone had sent in. And this gink would let out this horrible laugh of his. Pretty good some of them were, too. There was one that a plumber sent in.
If my memory serves me correctly, his option expires on August the 16th. Who does he think he's kidding? How much does this other guy want for his radio station?
He'll sell for $500,000.
Buy it.
Oh, yes. When you've said your last good night, Jonah, listen.
Yes, darling, I am listening.
When you've said your last good night, turn out your Borealis light and think of all the things you've done. And can't you bless
me? Who handles the Borealis account?
A good boy and man.
Ah.
Plumber, imagine.
A plumber? Who
else?
The man who sent it in. Oh. I thought it was kind of cute.
Great, darling, great. Send a memo to Johnny Mount. Mention that space will be available on this radio station we just bought in. What's the name of the city?
Autopsy.
Autopsy. Autopsy? $500,000 for a radio station in Autopsy. $350, tops.
Tops, right.
How did the show go? Oh, yes, you were just talking.
Well, if it hadn't been this guy who kept laughing, I could have killed him.
There you are, sir, now. You know, the agency was just crazy about your show, Miss Townsend. They simply raved.
You know how it is when someone keeps laughing.
Well, how did that San Francisco call?
Oh.
Check that number. Oh, Bill, have you got it with you?
Right here, John.
The geologist's report.
What happened to that San Francisco call?
I want you to have it with you as an exhibit. When the stockholders see that, we won't have any more trouble with them. Berg, get that report.
The last four pages.
Uh-huh.
Let me get a little powder.
You were sensational. I caught your show last night. The first half, I'm ashamed to say I missed it. But you were wonderful, just wonderful.
Oh, you saw me last night? Oh, I feel so embarrassed.
And when you had the fellas change hats with the girls, it wasn't the greatest thing.
I'm having trouble on a call to San Francisco. Rosemont, 4681.
That?
There's an extremely ambiguous clause here. Bill, quit fooling with that thing. You pay attention to this, too. There's one sentence here that says that we can buy stock at any time within the 12-month period, and the next sentence virtually contradicts this. The whole clause will have to be redrafted. Oh, honey, about tonight. I'm afraid I shan't be able to get away until after 10.
Oh, Jonah.
I'll tell you what I'll do. I have Bill, you wouldn't mind, would you? You pick Dottie up at 8 o'clock. Would that suit you? Pick Dottie up at 8 o'clock and take her over to the Rainbow.
Glad to, Jonah.
Order dinner if you're hungry. I'll join you as soon as I can.
Anything at all.
So long, honey. What most men want and spend a lifetime trying to acquire, I already had. But I wanted something else, and I hadn't the faintest idea what it was. And the reason for my working 16 hours a day was simply an effort on my part to avoid having to find an answer to that question. I suppose that I might have gone on avoiding it indefinitely if it had not been for the accidental intervention of Jack Studebaker, the theatrical producer, who'd come to my office to borrow money for one of his shows. He was a man whose income in a good year might be $500,000, but who rarely had the kind of money that it takes to buy a new suit. He'd explored every known method of losing money. But he also represented a very large chunk of that indefinable something that I wanted. Whenever he created a work of art, I wanted part of it. And I was ready to pay him for it. Are you sure $150,000 is going to be enough?
Ample. Great combination, this. Your money, my talent.
Next time, I recommend that you find a formula for cutting your running costs. With your last show, you ran to capacity for 9 months before you were out of the red.
Well, this time it's going to take even longer. Don't kid yourself. This time we're going to have two orchestras.
Two orchestras?
Yes, two orchestras, one in the pit and one on stage.
So what about your income tax?
What about my income tax?
Well, don't you want to clear yourself with the tax authorities?
I can hardly see what this has got to do with having two orchestras or not.
I seem to remember that you owed the government something in the neighborhood of $150,000 in back taxes. I was hoping that with all the money you made on your road shows last year, you might be almost in the clear by now.
How naive can you get?
How much is it now? $200,000? Yes? Who's going to handle the byproducts? Why, we are, of course. Didn't we foreclose on the Evans factory? Well, if that isn't enough, take up as an option on the two adjacent sites. Yes, get the bank to cover it. What's the hurry? Didn't finish talking.
Well, we finished talking about my income tax situation. Now, if you want to talk about anything else, you'll find me in the bar downstairs.
Good drink.
Oh, I had one already myself, thank you very much. Doesn't taste the same in an office, though.
I'm expecting an important call from San Francisco. You go ahead, go down to the bar if that's what you want. I'll join you in a few minutes.
Jonah, I have a wonderful idea. Why don't we both go aboard my yacht and take off for a few days fishing, hmm?
Your yacht? You mean you say you haven't sold that yet?
Why would I want to sell my yacht?
The crew, the upkeep, the harbor due.
Jonah, this is my yacht you're talking about.
Yeah, but what about your income tax position?
Oh, Jonah, you're pathetic. Really, you are. I'm awfully sorry for you. That you should have the audacity to sit there and criticize the way I live. You think a yacht is a waste of money because you wouldn't know what to do with it. You prefer to buy five and dime stores. Your only hobby is to sit in your office here and cultivate your ulcers.
I have no ulcers.
Oh, well, all right, so you have no ulcers. But instead of taking advantage of this situation and eating the most beautiful food that money can buy, what do I find you tucking away? A club sandwich and a carton of drugstore coffee. You have no interest in the world strong enough to wean you away from this sordid accumulation of wealth. You're nervous, you're excitable, you're...
Oh, Johnny, you're ridiculous. I'm the least neurotic person in a neurotic world. If I were neurotic like the rest of you, I wouldn't be so happy.
Happy? Huh. Oh. Yes? Johnny Watson? He's gone to the ball game.
My call! Send for the caddy!
Responsible interfering.
Jonah, I'm sorry. I really am sorry. I didn't mean to hit you. But for some reason or other, I just can't abide people hitting me in the face. I never could. That's what broke up my last two marriages. Oh, Jonah, open your eyes. Please believe me, I didn't mean to hurt you. How are your teeth, huh? Are they all right? None of them broken? Ah, come on, let me help you up. That's it. You sit back in that chair there and relax, and I'll tell you all about my income tax.
Go away. I don't care. I don't want to hear it.
Well, it's not the amount I owe the government, but I seem to have done something mildly evasive. No, don't move. I'll get it for you. Scotch, wasn't it? Yeah. You remember the government took possession of my two houses and my nightclub and sold them? Well, that's all straightened now. And so are my alimonies. My yacht. Now, I seem to have forgotten to mention my yacht. Don't move. Allow me. I'll get it for you.
Speaking, yes.
Oh, it's you. Yes, darling, I didn't realize. Yes, I'm sorry, darling, I was tied up. Well, you mean to say the restaurant's closed already? Oh, well, Bill will be able to take you home, all right, huh? Yes, darling, I'm sorry. Yes, I'm sorry.
Good night.
Yep. Dotty, she's mad. I work all night and she gets mad. If I hadn't worked 16 hours a day, I'd never have pursued Dotty in the first place. And I wouldn't have worked 16 hours a day if I'd been the sort of person who knew what he wanted. Well, at least I was beginning to know what I didn't want. I didn't want poor Dotty. I didn't want my telephones, my desk, my corporations. I didn't want any of the things I had. As a matter of fact, I didn't have them. They had me. What did I want? After an undignified exchange of blows with my oldest friend, I just couldn't go on without making a determined effort to find out. Huh. All right. I'd let the telephone ring. I'd walk out on my empire. Somewhere along the line, I'd lost track of my original objective. I'd go back to where I'd started from and see if I could pick it up. But I found that I'd left the office without providing myself with enough money, even to pay for a night's lodging. And to be short of money, to that extent, at once creates a dangerous situation. Any business transaction that I undertook was liable to set me up in an office chair similar to the one that I'd just vacated. Indeed, on the very first evening of my new life, I became momentarily the owner of a string of taxicabs. I didn't want them. The finger of destiny was pointing in a direction I wished to avoid. But until I had enough ready cash to make good my disappearance, I could not afford to ignore any promising source of increment. Although my financial empire could operate quite smoothly without me, and my disappearance would cause only the mildest flutter on Wall Street, I was not anxious to be in my own city when it happened. I didn't even want to be in the same continent. The oil wells, the bricks and mortar, the corporations, even the playing cards were now behind me. My conscience gave me a small twinge when I thought of Dotty. After all, she was very fond of me, but she was not the sort to remain unsponsored for long.
For me? Why, it's lovely.
It's not everyone
man who can become a nobody at the drop of a hat. I was now faced with the task of making enough money to live on without applying my own special brand of business acumen. I was dismayed at the diversity of talents in which I now found myself to be lacking. But the man of character who aspires to a certain position in life will not long go unrewarded. And I found almost the perfect career in which to pass myself off as a nobody. It afforded me plenty of fresh air and some opportunity for reading.
Here, what do you think you're doing? Get on with your work.
But it was hardly the rich, full life that I was reaching for. The higher I rose in the social scale, so my frustrations multiplied. I could not bear to see telephones remain unanswered. In the past, some of my best friends had been telephones. Then there were certain fields of activity in which my expertness was beyond question. But I found that when separated by a sheet of glass, card players showed a lamentable lack of tolerance towards kibitzers. And not only card players. I began to realize that every window has a right side and a wrong side. I was definitely on the wrong side. I discovered one of those rare households still wealthy enough to employ a full complement of domestic servants. Her name was Lily. She was a conscientious girl with excellent references.
Here, take your dirty things off my clean ironing.
And a sweet, unspoiled disposition.
I'm sorry, darling. I wasn't thinking.
Her mistress had a less attractive disposition. Fortunately, I saw very little of her. Nor did the master of the house ever allow me to see very much of him. He was a retired tycoon who'd operated on both sides of the Atlantic. He'd even had dealings with some of my own corporations. We'd never met face to face, and it was unlikely that he'd even seen my picture in the paper. Nevertheless, I thought it was just as well to fortify myself with an alias.
Babcock.
Yes, sir.
There were 3 buttons missing from the shirt you laid out for me this morning.
I'm sorry, sir, an oversight. Is there anything else, sir?
Isn't that enough?
Yes, sir. Here's a man who's devoted his entire life to the accumulation of money, and what's he got?
He's got a lot more than you're likely to have at his age.
Well, strictly in terms of money, perhaps.
He's even got a yacht.
Well, what's the good of a yacht if he doesn't use it? It just lies in the harbor, running up expenses.
Well, he's been everywhere.
All right, so he has a yacht.
He's even been to America.
Well?
Well, have you been to America?
Yes, I have.
You have? Well, why didn't you tell me? We'd have had something to talk about these past few weeks. What's it like?
It's just the same as any other place. Of course, it's bigger. In fact, it's enormous. They have lots of oil wells and skyscrapers and chain stores and television stations. I didn't get around an awful lot. I was working most of the time.
But didn't you meet anyone? I mean, didn't anyone famous ever come to the house where you worked?
No, I don't think so.
Well, what's Hollywood like?
Hollywood? I'm not sure that I ever went to Hollywood.
I don't believe you've ever been to America.
I did, honestly, darling. I swear I did. I was there for years.
Something fishy about you. Can't even sew a button on properly. I don't believe you're even a real valet.
Well, it's true that I didn't work as a valet when I was in America. I acted more in a secretarial capacity.
Oh? Doing what, pray?
I answered the telephone most of the time.
Oh, telephone operator.
An operator.
You're not even sure if you've ever been to Hollywood?
Yes, I am, now that you come to mention it. We bought some oil property in Southern California, and I had to fly out to the coast because it looked like one of the big companies was trying to double-cross us. Oh, yes, I remember now. They took us to lunch at some country club, and they pointed out a fellow who came there to play golf, and they said that he had some connection with the movie business. Is there someone called, Bob Pope? Well, yes.
Oh.
Huh? After this, there was no longer any shortage of conversation. She was crazy about the names I learned to drop. And I was out of my mind about her. In fact, I was in such a state that I made a very rash move.
I haven't made a move in 3 weeks.
I noticed that, sir.
My opponent lives in Mexico. In his last letter, he threatened to checkmate me in 3 moves. Checkmate in 3 moves. Ha! he doesn't take my castle, he's done for.
Well, if you'll excuse me, sir, I think I should go upstairs and turn down your bed.
Nonsense. Just every day I find myself a chess player. How about a game now?
If I can be of service, sir.
You can sit down and set out the men while I put in a call to Mexico. And tell my friend I've got him on the run. Cigar?
Why, thank you, sir.
Do you play for money?
Well, he asked for it.
Jonah.
Oh, good morning, darling.
What do you suppose I just heard?
What?
They're thinking of taking a cruise on the yacht.
Does that mean we have to go with them?
Well, of course.
Oh.
Well, aren't you pleased?
Well, can't they leave us here to look after the house?
But they're going to Florida.
Florida? Oh, no.
America, just think.
I don't want to go to America.
Everyone wants to go to America.
I've been there.
Well, why don't you think of someone else besides yourself for a change?
I am. I'm thinking of you. You've never been on a yacht. You'll be as sick as a dog all the way across the Atlantic. The first gale, it'll sink with all hands. And you know what the Atlantic's been like since the war. There are mines floating around. Ships being blown sky high. You read about it all the time. Then you get becalmed and you run out of water. Crew starts drinking seawater. Everybody goes mad and albatrosses start swooping down and pecking out your eyes. Oh.
Are you a fugitive from the FBI?
So what if you do go to Florida on the yacht? You're a lady's maid, for goodness sake. You probably won't even be allowed ashore. You'll be stuck in some miserable cabin ironing Mrs. Nell's sun suits. You're staying here with me. We're both going to give notice and find a new job as a couple.
Take your filthy hands off me.
Destiny was playing an effective game at my expense. Forcing my hand, you might say. The old boy turned out to be a very fancy gambler. And I was doing him a great service. He'd never been so happy in his life. At least not since his retirement.
Oh, why, I thought I had you that time.
Bad luck, sir.
Well, don't spend it all on women.
For me? Why, it's lovely. I shall save it for the cruise. Guess what I'm doing? I'm copying one of Mrs. Nell's sun suits. They wear these all the time in Miami.
You really believe, don't you, that all you have to do is to step ashore on American soil in a homemade sun suit and a string of millionaires will ask you for your hand?
Well, why not? I've got an English accent.
Why does everyone have to be a millionaire? Well, I hardly need tell you what happened after that. I had a little business on the stock market, but I was working under pressure. There were only 2 or 3 weeks before we were due to set sail.
For me? Why, it's lovely.
I didn't want to rob an old man of his plaything, especially since it happened to be a yacht. Tax-wise, it could be nothing but a liability, and even less could be said for it as a means of transportation. But I just couldn't bear the thought of Lily sailing to America in anyone else's yacht but my own. Destiny had been tugging at me ever since I left this office, and finally she made it. She tugged me back into line. Yes? Movie theaters? Who wants movie theaters nowadays? Yes, I know the lots are worth that much, but what are you going to do with the bricks and mortar? As I was saying, each man is the victim of his own destiny.
Nuts.
Well, if you don't like that explanation, it's simply the age-old story of a man making the supreme sacrifice for the love of a good woman.
And just how good is she?
Lily?
Yes, Lily.
She's good, I'm telling you. Look what I gave up. I was on my way to becoming a well-adjusted nobody with an opportunity to enjoy my leisure, and then I had to fall in love.
No, you're a liar.
It's true, I did.
Okay, I don't deny that you may have fallen in love, but everything else you've said is so much bunk.
Excuse me for a moment. Help yourself to a drink.
Thank you. Well, he did.
Send 3 copies of this to Washington and get a clearance from the OPWFC. Has Rosencrantz checked it?
Yes, sir, he has, sir.
And Guildenstern?
Yes, sir.
Yes? Answer that.
Excuse me, sir.
Sorry, put it in writing. Send a copy to Rosencrantz.
Sir. That would be a matter for Good Boy and Man. It comes under the heading of Substandard Theatrical Ventures.
Put him through.
Yes, Johnny Mann allocates the personnel.
So long, Jonah. It's been nice talking to
you.
Republic Van.
Yes. Texas is already absorbed. Alaska, now you're...
Oh, I'm afraid he's tied up right now.
Yes?
I shall.
Mr. Watson? I'm sorry. I'm afraid he's tied up a little bit now.
I won't move unless you give me Canada.
Oh. Well, in that case, I suppose I could untie him.
Excuse me, sir.
That suits me.
This is a very wealthy voice.
Oh, Reuben. Reuben? Yes, last week. Oh, nothing at all. I'm planning to settle down and raise a family. Sure, come right over. You were saying?
Oh, how do I know what I was saying? How can anyone carry on an intelligent conversation in this office when every moment you expect it to be shattered by a battery of telephone bells?
You're saying my affairs were so much bunk?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, by golly, I was, and I meant it, too.
I want all of Global Graphite's quarterly reports for the past 5 years.
I'm expected to believe that falling in love was a new case, so unique, so momentous, and such an unprecedented an event that it awakened in you a new sense of responsibility. That had you not met this paragon of womanhood, you would be content to bask in obscurity indefinitely. Bunk, Jonah, bunk.
Oh, that reminds me. There's a small part in the second act of your new show that I'd like Lily to play.
Oh, fine.
It's part of the Swedish manicurist who steals the microfilm. Have you any objection?
No. Has she got any talent? No, don't bother to answer that question. Jonah, it's my duty to disillusion you. I've got to tell you why your experiment was a failure.
I don't want to be disturbed.
Jonah, that's the nicest thing you've ever said to me.
Go on.
Well, life without wealth was insupportable and frightening. You have absolutely no talent in this world except this one freakish ability to gamble successfully.
Business is not gambling.
Well, don't interrupt. You understand figures. You can multiply and subtract. You can play with. You can make schemes and you can make patterns. You can even play chess, and that's a very great talent. But you never play except for money. You never play, period. You don't understand that side of life, and consequently you're afraid of it. You try to protect yourself from all true responsibility by wrapping yourself round in a blanket of $1 bills.
Oh, I forgot to tell you that Mr. Van Marta is coming round to see me. Is he there?
Yes, but there's a Mrs. Watson.
Mrs. Watson? Oh, Mrs. Watson, Lily, send her in.
There you are, you see. You're afraid to keep a business associate waiting, but you'd forgotten all about your wife.
Go away, Jack. I'm tired of you.
No, I don't think I will. Matter of fact, I think I'll wait and meet your wife.
How'd you do?
Lily, come in, darling. I want to introduce my old friend Jack Studevant, my wife Lily.
Charmed, I'm sure.
How do you do?
Jonah, what do you suppose I've been doing?
I've no idea.
I've been seeing the woman about my clothes.
Which particular clothes?
The clothes for the show, of course.
Why, yes, of course.
I'm playing a part in a new musical show that Jonah's backing.
Oh, how nice.
Mr. Studevant here happens to be the producer of the show. You two ought to get together.
Well, what a coincidence. I've heard of you. You're quite famous, really. Jack Studevant presents. I've seen it on the tops of theatres.
Oh.
Well, I suppose I ought to tell you what I was thinking of wearing.
Hello?
I know.
Oh, it's
about
you. I was just going to ring you, as a matter of fact. Did you get a copy of Global Graphite's report?
Now, first of all, she's supposed to be a spy, right?
Right. Yes.
And she's supposed to be Swedish,
yes, I'm
right?
Yes, right now.
Well, I thought I'd dye my hair blonde.
Why don't we both go and
do you think it'd suit me?
Yes, it suits most brunettes.
And then seeing that most of the action takes place in a castle.
No, I don't agree.
I thought an eau de nar negligee over a pink sheath.
Hold on. Darling, I don't want to keep you waiting. Why don't you and Jack go ahead and have your lunch?
Well, that's a fine idea. Then we can talk about our show.
I've got to wait here for Reuben Van Marta. He won't keep me very long. If the worst comes to the worst, I'll join you for coffee, right? I'm sorry, I have some people here.
Well, come on, I'm starving. I can't get used to this 3 meals a day. Where I used to work, we ate our heads off.
Give me Blodgett's in San Francisco. Make it a personal call to Farrow. What happened to that memo that Rosencrantz sent me about Consolidated? Oh, it's all right. I've got it right here in front of me. Don't bother. Aaron, I'm sorry to keep you waiting. Yeah, I put the call through to Blodgett's. What was it that I wanted? I never found out. But fortunately, there are always new things to want, and none of us lives long enough to get them all. So there seems to be no reason why I shouldn't go on wanting happily ever after. Thank you.
of your life.
What do you mean by that?
Well, don't you see? You want to be something that you're not. Didn't I hear you say you wanted to be a film producer?
Yes.
You just don't have the temperament for it. You'll talk about it, but you'll never do anything about it. You're just like Jonah Watson. He'll spend the rest of his life making big business deals over long-distance telephone. And you'll spend the rest of yours growing beards and dressing up as Rupert of Hensar. You'll never produce anything.
It's a very depressing thought. It might have been such fun.